brother, sister, in the Dharma, the question tonight we're going to ask, I hope that it doesn't hurt, the opposite sex. Can you elaborate on this? When women enter the order, the sublime Dharma will only last for 500 years. So what we personally feel that there is some sort of discriminations. Thank you.
So why do you worry about that? You are not a woman.
That is not your business.
This question must come from a lady. So you have sympathy towards them, isn't it?
Yeah, this is a very big controversial issues. It is mentioned that in spite of various difficulties and problems, in the end, the Buddha has agreed and given permission for ladies to enter into the holy order as bhikkhunis. This is the first time in the religious history that women were given such an equal religious right in any religion, even before or after the Buddha's time. Even today, although women are educated, working with hand in hand with men in many countries, still so-called advanced religions also never give full religious rights to women. In Australia, America, Europe, women are working and fighting for their equal right, asking the religious authorities to ordain them as priestess or bishop or archbishop, but they never agree. But the Buddha started this 2500 years ago. He has given full right for women to practice this religion, to conduct religious services, perform their religious duties without any discrimination. Later, women have proven that they are equally capable enough to attain the sainthood, to develop their intellectual capacity, understanding and wisdom. So it clearly shows that men have not given freedom to women from the very beginning. Now let us take the origin of man and woman, how those religions explain to us. First, God created man, but not woman. So the discrimination, man is given the prominent place. Man must come first, but in the West, woman first. Even then, they are reluctant to give this full freedom, religious rights to women. So after that, after taking a rib from the man's body, God created woman. Now this is the way how they explain the appearance or existence of man and woman in this world. But Buddhism never says like this. According to the Buddha, when the formation of this earth and this planet has taken place, when the environment and atmosphere and facilities are available for life to exist,
the Brahmas or Devas from other planets came down. And they had no sex. They are free from sex formation. So when they appeared on this earth, there's no sex formation. Later, when greed, attachment, affection, love, these emotional feelings developed in their mind, sex formations have taken place as male and female. Now this is the way how Buddhism explains. Not created by God. Then all the other defilements such as jealousy, anger and various other defilements also develop. On the other hand, some other good qualities like kindness, compassion and understanding and so many good qualities, both started to develop in their mind. Then you can ask, how did they get these ingredients into their mind? Who created them? There was nobody to create them. I think you have heard, those who have developed their meditation to control their mental impurities and greed and lust and various mental impurities from their mind, after their death, rebirth take place in one of those Brahma realms where they experience more peace, more calm and contented, peaceful life. Even then, they have not completely eradicated the main roots of craving, lust and mental impurities. Remember this. Circumstances can arouse their feeling, and again those hidden mental emotion, impurities, craving, jealousy, anger can be seen, develop. So what happened here? When these Brahmas were there, circumstances or way of life there is such that they can maintain the purity. But here in this world, this is a kama loka, where people, living beings, experience sensual pleasure. So when they appear on this earth, circumstances arouse, stir their mind, and then started to develop those hidden, the mental impurities, and then the sex formation. Later, from the very beginning, discrimination, man and woman. Man is higher, man is superior, woman is inferior. This feeling, even today, the majority here in this world maintain this belief. The word in the English language say manpower, mankind, refer to man. They say yes, man, when you say man, woman also there. It's not that. At the beginning they have created this word by considering only man. But today many people don't use this mankind. They say humankind, not mankind, not manpower, human power. And then both are included there. Now this is the way how they have discriminated. So the Buddha had a very hard time, because the situation in India, can you imagine? 2,500 years ago, the situation in India, how people regarded women, you can understand this very well. Even in the West, how they discriminate women today in the 20th century. Here you can understand what sort of courage, understanding, compassion the Buddha had to accommodate or to welcome women folk into the holy order. At the beginning, he did not agree. The main idea was to make them to understand the difficulty of this way of life. The Buddha says, this way of life is not suitable for ladies. It is true. Because at that time, there were no proper monasteries or temple for monks to stay. They were sleeping under the trees or roadside or jungles and caves and various open areas. So women cannot lead this way of life. By considering all these things, the Buddha says, this way of life is not suitable for women. Then the Buddha's stepmother, Mahapajapati Gotami, the one who requested, he say, 7 days after giving birth, your mother died. I had to look after you as your own mother. Why can't you listen to my word? I am your mother, asking this favor. Then the Buddha said, it is very difficult. He had to go back. Second time also she came, requested. Then the Buddha says, can't you understand that this way of life is not suitable for women? Therefore, I am sorry, I cannot agree. Third time also she came. He says, sorry. Then what she did not give up hope. She got hold of Venerable Ananda, the Buddha's attendant, explain everything to him. Please go and approach on our behalf. Tell him how we feel. Tell him that we are willing to undergo any kind of suffering. Asking this permission, grant this permission for us to lead a holy life. Then the Buddha says, okay, come. Then he gave 8 conditions. If you agree to observe these 8 conditions, so I am willing to welcome you, ordain you as fully ordained nuns. Then he says, yes, we are willing to do that. But these 8 conditions, when we analyze one by one, I have no time to explain now, you can understand, he had to introduce for their own protection, to maintain their dignity. Otherwise, they may get into trouble. By knowing the mentality of women at that time, by knowing how the public treat them, to avoid misunderstanding, calamities, disturbances, he had to introduce these 8 conditions. They agreed, ordained. Then, first started from royal families. Many of those relatives from the Buddha's families. Later, the Buddha's former wife, Yasodhara, also became a nun. They have proven that they too can lead a holy life. The story that you have heard, I think some of our members are not aware of it. A lady who studied how to meditate from a group of monks. Because these monks went to a certain area or a certain village to continue their meditation. And this lady invited those monks to stay and promised to attend to them, look after them, provide dana and everything. Then she also learned how to meditate from this monk. So what happened? This lady has attained the third stage of sainthood. Sotapanna, Sakadagami, Anagami. Third stage of sainthood. But these monks have not yet attained. Those who taught her how to meditate. Can you imagine this? Therefore, how can we say that ladies have low mentality? Ladies cannot develop their mind because they were not given this opportunity in the human history. Then what happened? Those who have attained the third stage of sainthood can read others' mind, what they think. So now this lady is watching what these monks are thinking in the monastery. So whenever this monk thought that tomorrow morning we like to have porridge for our breakfast, just think, and next day morning this lady brings porridge. This has been going on for some time. Then these monks had some sort of suspicion. Then one day they asked, how do you come to know that we wanted to have this? Who told you? She told, nobody told me. Then she told me very frankly, after studying how to meditate from you, I have attained the third stage of sainthood. Now I can understand your mind. I can read your mind. That's all. Then these monks discussed among themselves, what a disgraceful thing. Not only that, now you must be very careful. Because this lady knows everything what we think. So this has become a very, important point for them to be alert, to guard their mind, to concentrate, to continue their meditation with diligently, without wasting their time. Then they also attain the higher stage. Now they wanted to find out. Now they can read her mind. Not only that, they can understand, they can recall the previous life also. Because the monks have gone higher than the lady's third stage. They thought, today we have attained this higher stage of sainthood because of this lady. And I think this lady might have helped, supported us even during our previous birth. Now they wanted to find out what happened. Now see the nature of our life. During their previous birth, this lady was a wife of one of these monks. Not only that, She was very wicked, influenced another man to kill her own husband. They found out this secret. Now the monks are reading. At that time, the lady also has attained the higher stage. She was watching the monk's mind. So the monk stopped. No need to study one after the other. This is enough. This is the nature of our existence. Then the lady came. She knew that these monks have found out that she was responsible for killing her own husband during their previous birth. Then this lady said, "Don't stop. Continue." And then they have gone to the other one, previous one. At that time they found out that this lady also the wife of the same person. That is how the attachment, love, affection, we continue life after life, like magnetic power. At that time, this lady could manage to save her husband from another person who tried to kill him. Then lady say, "You see, now there is no reason for you to get fed up, isn't it?" This incident is more than enough for you to understand how far they also can develop their mind. Now there is a question you can ask, isn't it? If this lady has influenced another man to kill her own husband, what happened to this bad karma she has committed? How did she get the chance to become a human being again and to continue meditation to attain sainthood? Isn't it? Naturally, this question appears in your mind. The nature of karma is such. Certain karmas are belong to karma patha. Karma patha means unchangeable, unshakable. Other karmas cannot change, cannot topple. But certain karmas are changeable. By using another karmic force, the effect of the karmas can be changed. So that means this lady has done more good karmas, more weighty and heavy karmas, although she has done that bad action, bad karma. That is why she had the chance to become a human being again and could manage to develop her mind through her meditation. Now this is the nature of karma. Well, let us come back. The Buddha's attitude, how he regarded women, there are many incidents. One day, King Bimbisara, there were two kings always associated with the Buddha. When he was talking, Kosala, yes, when he was talking to the Buddha, somebody came and told him, queen, because at that time, queen was expecting a baby. Queen has given birth to a baby girl. And the king's face was very, very, turned into very sad mood, attitude. Then the Buddha asked, "Why? What happened to you? When you heard the queen has given birth to a baby girl, why do you want to show your sour face?" Then he told, "Actually, I was expecting a baby boy, not baby girl. Then the Buddha asks, what is wrong with baby girl? There, another occasion. Buddha said, there is no reason whatsoever for you to worry about that. Do you know? Mother, girl means mother. Mother is the one who gives birth and who look after, who nurture a man to become a ruler, to become a king. Do you know that? Why do you worry? See the way how Buddha consoled the king who was unhappy when the queen has given birth to a baby girl. Another occasion. These sayings you can see in Dhammapada. Naso sabvesu thanesu puriso hoti pandito. Ittipi pandita honti tattha tattha vichakkana. This saying was uttered by a deva, later confirmed by the Buddha. Yes, it is true. What is that? We should not think that man is the only wise person, always. Naso sabvesu thanesu puriso hoti pandito. Man is not the only pandita, always. Ittipi pandita honte, stri, also become pandita, become wise. See how he has given due credit to women's mind, that they too can develop their understanding, knowledge and wisdom. Again, the strong belief at that time in India, amongst the followers of various religions, that a woman never get the chance to attain arahantahood or sainthood or nirvana, or never can go to heaven, because they have no soul, only man got soul. Animals and women have no soul. Later they change. Then what did they say? If a woman wants to go to heaven, she must attend to her husband, look after him, pay respect to him, and then she can go to heaven. That means, when she wants to go to heaven, she had to use the husband's passport. Because she is not entitled to get a separate passport. Can you understand the situation at that time? In fact, the whole world, the women must be grateful to the Buddha, whatever religion they practice, must be grateful to the Buddha. The only religious teacher who realized, who recognized, who has given full freedom to practice their religion without any discrimination. I told you, even today, in many other religions, are still not given. When they attend to various religious functions in their places of worship, man and woman cannot mix up. And here, there's no problem. We have not separated this section only for the men and this only for the women. Why? We regard all of them as human beings, especially in the temple. But in certain other places, cannot mix up. and certain other places, they must cover their face like this. They should not, women should not show their lousy faces to men in the places of worship. What is wrong? Why is it necessary to close their face? Do they think man cannot tolerate? You cannot find such attitude in Buddhism. There you can see no discrimination whatsoever. Again, in certain religion, it is mentioned, after giving birth, a woman cannot enter into a place of worship for a certain period. They are very dirty, therefore they cannot enter into a place of worship. There is no such thing in Buddhism. At any time, they can enter. Again, once a month during their period, other religions say women cannot enter into a place of worship. There is no such thing in Buddhism. And that is why Buddhism is known as religion of rhythm, religion of reason. Must give reason why. Blindly we are not going to accept anything. So only religion where women can experience religious freedom without any discrimination. Now the question is, the Buddha has given permission for women to enter into the holy order, right? Later, he has said, the pure dharma, here he is talking about sainthood. Pure dharma means sainthood. Pure dharma exists only for 500 years. Because women have entered into the holy order. Just because women were given this freedom to enter this holy order. Now the argument is this. If the Buddha said this, it is difficult for us to accept that the Buddha is an enlightened religious teacher. At the beginning, by knowing what will happen to his doctrine, his dharma, his holy life, he should have stopped this. But at that time he did not see this. If I allow you to enter into the holy order, my doctrine, my pure dharma, sainthood, and last only for 500 years. No, he never said. But it is recorded in the book that the Buddha said that sainthood can last only for 500 years because women were given this permission to associate with monks and to lead a religious life. Now another interpretation in the Buddhist book. First 500 years, we can see arahantas. After 500 years, arahantas slowly disappear. Now then remain sotapanna, sakadagami, anagami. Then the second 500 years, anagami also slowly disappear. Then remain sotapanna and sakadagami. Third 500 years, sakadagami also disappear. Remains only sotapanna. And the fourth 500 years, that means 2000. Fourth 500 years, sotapanna also slowly disappear. So according to this interpretation, now 2,500 years already gone. no more sotapanna, no more sagadagami, anagami or arahanta in this world. It is in the Buddhist book. Ordinary Buddhists remain, that's all. The monks and lay people all are ordinary Buddhists, that's all. Then what is the sayings of the Buddha that we can find in Mahaparinibbana Sutta, the last sermon? This is very important. Yavakivanche Subaddha Bhikkhu Samma Vihareyam Asunyo Loko Arahantehi Asa. This is the sayings of the Buddha. This is the real sayings of the Buddha in Mahaparinibbana Sutta. What does it mean? At that time, he was addressing to his last disciple, Subaddha. Subaddha was a follower of another religion. When he heard that the Buddha was a great religious teacher, he is going to pass away. So in a hurry, he visited Kusinara, the place where the Buddha was dying. Wanted to go and talk to the Buddha. Then Venerable Ananda said, "The Buddha is very weak. Please don't go and disturb him." Then Subaddha said, "No, I'm very keen. I came from far distance. I want to see him. I want to talk to him. Please allow me." Ananda said, "I'm very sorry. The Buddha is very weak. He cannot talk. Don't go and disturb him." The Buddha overheard this. Then he called Ananda. "Ananda, please allow him to come and see me." Then the Subaddha came, paid respect. He asked one question. He said, "You know, here in this country, there are many religions. I am the follower of one of those religions, although I cannot satisfy fully. And this religious teacher says like this, that religious teacher says like this, and the other teacher says like this." Then he went on explaining one after the other. "Now, what do you think about them?" This is the question. "What do you think about them?" Then the Buddha said, "Subaddha, don't ask me. My attitude towards them. If you want to know what I preach, I can tell you." Then he forgot all the other teachers' sayings and glorifications and everything. He said, "Yes, I want to know." And then only a few words. "I preach only this much," in simple language. Fully convinced, then he said, "I want to become one of your disciples." Then he called Ananda to ordain him, make him a monk, and given him ordinations and upasambada at the same time, because he had been leading a religious life for a long period, and not necessary to have a probation period for him, because he knew what religious life is. He was the last disciple of the Buddha. And to him, the Buddha says, "Subaddha, yavakivancha Subaddha, bhikkhu samma vihareyo."
But as long as my disciples follow my Dhamma, so long this world never become empty of arahantas. Always there are arahantas. There is no time limit for that. So this 500, 500, 500, all these things, allocations and divisions made by the disciples when they started to write this book. Remember this. There are many things that they have added like this. The Buddha has never said arahantas can last only for 500 and Sotapanna only 500 and Sakadagami only for 500. He has never said. And this is the sayings of the Buddha. It is meaningful. Now if we are not arahantas today, if you are not arahantas, if you are not holy, or if I am not holy, nothing wrong with the Buddha, nothing wrong with the Dhamma, nothing wrong with Buddhism, something is wrong with us. That's all. Don't blame Buddhism, don't blame the Buddha, something is wrong. No, something is wrong with us. We have some sort of weaknesses. That is why still we could not attain the highest thing. That is what the Buddha said. As long as my disciples follow the real Dhamma taught by me, you can find arahantas always here in this world. There is no time limit with that. But it is natural. You can see how morality, discipline, honesty, religious way of life, all the good qualities slowly decaying and dying and dying and declining, degenerate from our human mind. Followers of any religion, only for the namesake, they use their religious label. So that is our own weakness. We say, what to do? World is like this. That is our excuse. Any kind of immoral practices, corruptions, cruelty. We say, what to do? World is like this. Take simple example, business. When you come to business, everybody says, the world is like this, an honest man cannot do business. Yes, it is true. Therefore, you must be cunning and selfish and practicing smuggling, black marketing and all the immoral practices. The world is like this. So honesty is no more in the man's mind. That word remains only in the dictionary and in some religious book, but not in the man's mind. No honesty at all. So can we blame religion? That is why we are not arahantas or saints today. Then, direct answer to your question. At the beginning, Buddha has given permission for ladies to enter into the holy order. Later he has said, just because he has given permission for ladies to enter into the holy order, the holiness or the sacredness or the pure doctrine or the pure Dhamma disappear. Not just to be able. So what happened according to my own interpretation, my belief is this. Why there are no more arahantas? Oh, because ladies are allowed to enter into holy order, so arahantas disappear. What ridiculous is it? no meaning at all. Why do they want to blame women for that? They have not done anything. Can we say that they have created temptation in the man's mind or monk's mind to influence them? What about man? If the man's mind is strong, how can a man surrender to a woman? And why do we want to blame women only for that? If something is wrong, both are equally responsible, not only women. Man and woman, both are responsible. Because you must remember, we want to clap your hand, no noise, no sound, must have two hands, then sound comes. Because you must remember, we want to clap your hand, no noise, no sound, must have two hands, then sound comes. If immoral, wicked things between man and woman take place, both are equally responsible, then why do they want to blame women? This is a habit. In every religion, other religions are worse than Buddhism. They say, woman is the gate to enter into hell. That means the woman dragged the man also into hell. Just because of woman, poor man also had to go to hell. If there are no more women, you can see how man enjoys his life in this world. What sort of life? They will be in hell, actually. So what a ridiculous thing they have mentioned about women. They have differences by nature. It is true. Modern psychologists explain this very clearly. The man's way of thinking and woman's way of thinking, there are a lot of differences. But we should not regard these differences as weaknesses, as immoral or bad thing. That is our weakness. Because these differences are natural, and many of these differences are important. Opposite sex, always opposite side. If man and woman are equal, there is nothing in this world. Always there must be differences. That is why they are called, they belong to opposite sex. Then, let us analyze masculine qualities and the feminine qualities by nature. Man's attitude, by using his masculine qualities, power, strength, physical body, mind, he can become very aggressive, very violent, very adamant, very stubborn person because of the masculine qualities. Woman, because of her feminine qualities, she maintains more emotion. These emotions also appear in the woman's mind because of their physical body, hormone, different kind of hormone, not like man's. And serenity, pleasant looking, smiling face, and movement of their physical body, all these things are noticeable indications of feminine qualities. But man is not like this. Now when you see a small children, boys and girls, small boys and small girls, when they play, what sort of things they choose. Entirely different. And their attitude. They started from the very beginning these masculine and feminine qualities by nature. Again, a mother's feeling, mother means woman. The Buddha used this word, Matugama, a respectable word for woman, Matugama, mother. Every woman is a mother by nature, whether they give birth or not. So, Matugama is mother. They are natural feeling, not only amongst human beings. Motherly feeling. Man cannot develop this. Impossible for man to develop motherly feeling. Man can support. Wholeheartedly he can support, but cannot develop motherly feeling. But female, humans and animals, by nature, maintain that motherly feeling. It is not artificial. It is not created purposely by nature, naturally, that feeling, that affection, that inclination, this attachment, these responsibilities, so many things, willing to suffer with a smiling face because of their children. Man cannot do this. Man gets fed up very easily. When the baby is crying at night time, midnight, mother goes there. The father who wants to sleep, he gets up and shout and throw away this house. Not in this kind of sleep. This is the man's attitude. Man is like that. So, we regard this as a weakness. They are emotion. And they are resistant power. It's not like man. Because of that, very easily, a woman can change her mind. We think this is a weakness. That is the nature of feminine qualities. Very seldom you can see a female stand very firmly, very stubborn way. But man is not like that. Always I have to compromise. That is the woman's attitude. When father come and beat the child, mother had no other choice. He come and drag the child and go and apply some liniment, ointment. This is the nature of fathers and mothers. But both love this child equally. Father and mother. So by considering these things as weaknesses, because they are muscles, physical body, mental attitude, way of thinking, these things are not very rough and tough like man. Difficult to undergo certain difficulties and problems and calamities. That is why when there are some disturbances at home, although there are 10 to 12 ladies in that house, assume disturbances from thieves. And what do they say, these women at that time? Oh, what a pity, not a single man here in this house. There you can understand the woman's attitude. It is not their weakness. By nature they are like this. Very difficult for them to develop that, the resistant attitude, cruelty, to fight, to kill. Of course, there are. in the modern society, modern education, modern way of life, there are many, but even then, very, very few. So, this sayings, the holiness, sacredness, pure Dhamma, O Arahantas, disappear from this world just because ladies were allowed to enter into holy order is not acceptable for those who think unbiasedly. All right? Again, now you can understand why the Buddha was reluctant, did not agree at once by knowing the difficulty of this way of life. From India, this nunnery system disappeared after a few hundred years' time because of the difficulties. They could not maintain that for a long time. After a few hundred years, no news about nuns in India. But during the Buddha's time, there were thousands and thousands of nuns. Later, all disappeared because of the difficulty. Now let us take another country. Emperor Asoka's daughter, Sanghamitta, that is only 23 years after the Buddha, who introduced Buddhism to China, Mahinda. Later, Sanghamitta, the daughter of Emperor Asoka, Mahinda's sister, as a nun, she visited Sri Lanka and introduced this nunnery system. So it was flourishing at that country. It is mentioned in the history that this nunnery system was introduced to China from Sri Lanka. It is in the history. They have come from China and learned and ordained, gone back and introduced. And some nuns from Sri Lanka also gone to China to introduce this system. So in Sri Lanka also completely disappeared. Today there are few, they are not fully ordained nuns, regarded as there's no proper name also for them. Neither upasikas nor nuns in between. But not recognized as nuns. In China, of course, today we cannot expect medicine, but in Taiwan, in certain monasteries, there are few hundred nuns, only few monks. It's about 10 to 15 monks, 100 or 200 nuns in Taiwan. In Vietnam also there were many. So in certain countries, they introduced later. But in other countries, completely disappeared. The main reason for this is, if they really wanted to lead that way of religious life, monastic life, it's a very tough, very difficult way of life. Today we have, monks and nuns have all the facilities. Nice houses, good food, clothing, medicines, devotees, members, all the facilities are available today. But in those days, none of these facilities were there at that time. They had to struggle for their survival, to find out a piece of cloth, and no proper shelter. So, we cannot accept this saying as the Buddha's saying. If the Buddha has said like this, it is very difficult to accept the Buddha is an enlightened religious teacher to say so. Written by the disciples for their own protection. Accuse women and try to maintain their name both are equally responsible for the declining of sainthood. Not only nuns, monks and other lay people also equally responsible.
Yes. Any questions? I think our members also can answer this question. Very simple one, isn't it? Anybody who like to answer this question?
Are not enlightened persons. Sometimes their knowledge about the Dhamma or the nature is inferior to man's intelligence. Man can develop further and further and further. So many of those devas have no chance to develop their mind, but they enjoy their worldly pleasure, very pleasurable life they lead. This is the nature of deva. Just now I mentioned those who have come down from heaven, they are not devas, they are Brahma, higher than devas. So Brahmas have calmed and reduced many of those mental defilements or impurities that we are struggling. Through their meditation, when they were human beings, they have trained their mind properly. So after their death, rebirth has taken place because they have not eradicated their mind, the defilements completely. So they can maintain calmness and purity in their mind, but there is no guarantee circumstances again change their mind. Now this is the uncertainty of their life. Then the second part of your question is whether the devas are permanent or not. Definitely not. Now let us take, assume there are four religious groups, followers of four religions, main religions. Two religions teach heaven is the final goal, ultimate aim of our life, heaven or paradise. Only two religions. There are two more. Then another religion says, no, we have to go beyond this heaven. Now that is called Brahma world. Just now I was talking about it. Brahma world is the permanent, eternal, everlasting life because we were created by Brahma, Mahabrahma. So when we go back to the same place, it is called union with Brahma. To them, that is the final goal. And now Buddhism is alone here. Two religions, the followers of two religions remain in heaven, thinking this is their final goal. The followers of another religion gone further, beyond that, and remains in Brahma world, thinking this is their final goal. Then the Buddhist says, no, this cannot be the final goal. They want to go further. That is Nirvana. That is the only method discovered by the Buddha. This religious way of life, meditation, and religious duties and performances, practices were there, but their ultimate aim is either heaven or Brahma world. They have not learned to go beyond that. The Buddha, through his enlightenment, he found out all these places are still impermanent, changeable, although can last for thousands or millions of years, are still subject to this universal law of impermanency. Others could not understand this. It is due to this ignorance people think that they can enjoy everlasting life somewhere else. It is ignorance. Because they do not know how to analyze and understand the nature of existence. They do not know how life exists. They do not know what this life is. So devas and brahmas are not permanent, changeable. Yes? It is not that a law created by the Buddha. You understand? You cannot find any religious law created by the Buddha. But he realized the nature of action. Now let us say, action of killing. He pointed out, this action of killing is wrong under any circumstances. When we give our own reason, we have to kill because they are dangerous, they are poisonous, they are harmful. Again, some others say we have to kill them because we want to eat them. Some others say we have to kill them because they are nuisance. Some others say we like to kill them because we want to take skins and feathers and blood and this and that. Some others say, I wanted to kill them because they have done a lot of damages to us. All these are our excuses. But action of killing is natural. Our motive or the reason that we give is our own. The nature never agrees with us. So what the Buddha says, this is the nature. If you kill, you have to face the consequences. You are responsible for that. So it is not a law or commandment enforced by the Buddha. That is why his teaching is called dharma. Dharma means nature, natural occurrences. If you violate any of these natural law, nature, you have to face the consequences. If you want to avoid problems, difficulties, your duty is to harmonize, cooperate with this universal law. Then you are safe, you are protected. There he says, Dhammo have rakkati dhammachari. Dhammachari, one who lives in accordance with this dharma, with this universal law. That universal law protects. If you violate this, there's nobody to protect you. You have to face the consequence. So father and mother, they are solely responsible for our existence here. Although life is our own, but we are here in this world because of them. That is one of the reasons. Second reason, we are indebted to them forever. Whether they are good or bad, it is immaterial. And enormous troubles and pains and difficulties they have taken to look after, to attend, to bring up, to educate, to feed. So when you consider all these things in Sabrahmaka Sutra, one of the discourses, Anguttara Nikaya, the Buddha says, Brahmati Mata Pitaro पुब्बाचर्याति उच्चरे आहुनेयाच पुत्तानं पजाय अनुकंपका तस्माहिने नमस्सेय. यू सी द वे हाउ द बुद्ध हैज एक्सप्लेन आवर ड्यूटीज टुवर्ड्स आवर फादर एंड मदर. In simple language, father and mother both are the living God at home. Brahma means God at that time. Brahmati mata pitaro, mata and pitaro, father and mother. They are the living God at home. Regard them as God. Pubbacharya, the first teacher who taught us everything at the beginning from childhood. Later we have learned so many other things from outside. But the first teachers in the world who taught us everything, our father and mother. Ahuneya cha puttan, they are the one who attended for everything. They are the one who cried because of us. They cannot tolerate our suffering. They feel the child or children suffering as their own suffering. Others cannot. Therefore, it is your duty to attend to them, look after them, without neglecting them. In fact, he says, if you keep your father and mother, one side your father and the other side your mother, without keeping them on the ground, wash them, clean them, feed them, even then, you cannot pay back everything what they have done for you. They are failing. A king who used to attend to his own mother, who was very old, he did not allow outsiders to come and attend to him. You see, as a son, it is my duty to feed her, wash her, clean her, everything done by him, the king. So after her death, he started to cry. Then the ministers and some others came and tried to console him. Can't you understand? She was pretty old. It is quite natural. And why do you worry about her death? And the king said, I am not crying just because of that she died. I am not thinking about death. I missed a golden opportunity because of her death. Every time when I go and wash and clean and feed, how I felt, what sort of happiness I had in my mind at that time is no more. That is why I am crying. So not as a duty or what to do, it is my duty, I had to do that, I had to look after old lady and old man, what to do, that is not the way. That's what everybody say. So, if we kill them, how ungrateful we are, and the crimes or the offense is so grave, so it will become what you call a mortal sin. So in Buddhism it is called mortal sin. That means after committing this, we can do any amount of good karma to overcome. Impossible. We cannot do that. Now this is the danger of this. You know, King Ajatasattu, who killed his own father, King Bimbisara, during the Buddha's time, he realized he has done the biggest mistake in his life. Later he has become a very devout Buddhist. He thought, by doing more and more good karmas, that he will be able to overcome the bad karma that he has committed. But the monks also kept quiet, because he was doing good deeds, no harm. But impossible. Now this is the danger of this karma. First, they have to pay. But it is not permanent. Now this is the freedom. There is no everlasting suffering, permanent suffering. There is a limited period for them to suffer. After that, again come back. Get the chance to experience the good results of the good karmas that they have done. But many other religions say, whatever bad karma you have committed, you will be condemned to eternal hell, to suffer forever. Buddhism never agree with this.
Enough, I think. Coming to 9:30. Eh? Okay, sir.
आकाशट्ठा च बुम्मट्ठा देवानागा महिंदिका पुञ्यन्तं अनुमोदित्वा चिरं रक्खन्तु लोकशासनं इत्तावता च अम्मेहि सम्भृतं पुण्यसम्पदं सब्बे देवानुमोदन्तु सर्वसम्पत्तिसिद्ध्या देवो वसतु कालेन सर्वसम्पत्तिहेतु च पीतो भवतु लोको च राजा भवतु धम्मिको इदं वो जातीनां होतु सुखिता हन्तु ज्ञातयो इमिना पुण्यकम्मेन मामे बालसमागमो सतं समागमो तु याव निब्बानपत्त्या।